don't think it's specifically an audit issue, should be discussed today, and I made that point in a meeting with the chair and senior council officers this morning. When I took the intervention, when it took the intervention of the Information Commissioner's Office to force publication of the 2015, 2017 and 2019 internal audit reports to come to light, there are clear flaws in the way scrutiny is conducted in this council. A full reset of its culture is required so that the errors of the past don't happen again. I and the Liverpool Community Independence Group will be achieving full rigorous transparency at the emergency council meeting on November 23rd. I believe the way the company was established, the way it ran with unticketed cash taken, failures over business rates and VAT, poor auditing and governance, possible nepotism and appointments, suggests it must be subjected to investigation with an independent element. I'm sure there's no obstacle to BCO returning to the audit committee as early as the November meeting. Questions about BCO will not go away, nor will those councillors committed to the fullest transparency and open governance in this council.
Okay, Councillor, thank you for that. Moving on then, item number four. future capital scheme was funded by borrowing. So there is going to be a full review of the capital programme going forward. So we've got a double whammy really, we've got rising interest and rising inflation. So in terms of the cost of borrowing and the cost of actually delivering the scheme, you know, it's a double threat really to the scheme and affordability. So going forward, as Richard's pointed out, we have to build into the revenue budget, capital financing costs. So obviously the council will need to decide and enlarge the affordability going forward of those capital financing costs in the revenue budget, looking at all the other services as well.
Deadlines are has to contain a narrative report. Okay, so this is the document that sits in front of the detailed statements and all the detailed notes, etc. It's a statement that aims to tell the story about what's happened during the year. It focuses on the most significant financial and accounting issues, as we said, for the main issues that occurred this year as the impact of the pandemic and the impact of the best value inspection. That's underwritten a lot of things that we've done during the year. It also refers to some of the key facts and figures for the city, and it looks at the budget in relation to both revenue and capital in terms of what we intended to spend and in terms of what the outturn was. It then picks up what some of the key balance sheet items are, such as pensions, property, plant and equipment, and also looks at reserves. And it also looks at some of the key issues that are likely to impact on our finances in the future. It also picks up, again, issues about new accounting policies and several other things, which are basically leasing standards. Okay, so one of the key statements is what's called a comprehensive income and expenditure statement, or the CIES. What this statement does is it brings together all the gains and the losses that the council has sustained during the year. And the format matches the accounting practices of a large commercial organisation. So in other words, it includes the true costs of depreciation, it looks at pensions, it looks at gains and losses from asset disposals. In other words, it just shows all the transactions that a large organisation would do. It also shows the cost of providing council services. I think one of the key things to note though is that it's not on the same basis as the budget monitoring or the outturn reports. In effect, what happens is because the CIS picks up what I would call a lot of technical accounting adjustments, such as depreciation, cost of pensions, a lot of these transactions and costs don't work their way through into the way we calculate our budget and our council tax. In effect, what happens is that they're reversed out, and they're reversed out through a statement or moving to a reserve statement. So, for instance, whilst depreciation might affect this particular statement, it doesn't affect the amount that we collect from our council taxpayers because it's reversed out. Okay, so here is the CIS, just a very simple format. So in terms of expenditure, how much we spend, it's approximately 1.7 billion. How much income will we got in? It's approximately 1.8 billion. So what's the surplus or deficit for the year? The statement shows we've got 157 million pounds surplus. Clearly we haven't, so what's going on? So as I said before, is what happens here in the comprehensive expenditure statement, it picks up all the council's transactions for the year, revenue, capital, all of the technical accounting adjustments, etc. All those sorts of transactions that would appear in a large commercial organisation. But as I said before, a lot of these transactions don't work their way through to the council's budget. So whilst we've determined 157 million surplus for the year, the surplus which actually turns up in the general fund is a significantly different figure. I'll come back to that in a minute. So as we look at expenditure on services, again, some of these technical, we've got a loss on selling our assets in the year. We've got net costs for levies, such as the transport levy. We've got financing costs, so these are the interest costs that we pay in the year, plus any costs in relation to settling our borrowing early. The year before, there was a pension adjustment, but that's not there for this year. I'll come back to pensions a little bit in a minute. A little bit about our income, council tax, business rates, government grants, fees and charges. Oh, and there's the pension adjustment. So it was over there the year before, and it's over here. So it's expenditure the year before, it's income this year. I say pensions, as they flow through the CIS, are mainly technical adjustments. So it's stated on the side, so that's not where we've gone from one position to the next. So as I said, pension remeasurements has changed by 256 million. Okay, so we mentioned the general fund balance before, and all the technical adjustments are reversed out through the movement in reserve statement. And I think disclosure 10 provides a full reconciliation of that. Okay. So if we look at the general fund balance, what we know is we started the year with 17 million. We've got 157 million surplus for the year. And what we've done in effect is we've taken out £203 million worth of technical accounting adjustments to arrive at a figure of £29 million for the year. And when we draw down reserves, our general fund balance is over £20 million. So that's the figure which is important in terms of the council's budget. That's the working balance, £20 million. reserves are the way the technical adjustments are taken out of the CIS. They go through the reserve statement and end up on the balance sheet as this figure here, unusable reserves. So it's not a thing we can spend, it's a way in which all the technical adjustments are washed out. Okay. Let's have a look at some of the key balance sheet figures. So we can see assets on one side. The key asset is property, plant and equipment. We've got other assets. Actually, it's changed the assumptions and the bases on which everything's calculated, and that's flowed through us. a deficit on the collection fund of 77 million at the end of the year. It's not a real deficit. It's a deficit caused by the fact that when we set the budget, the government changed the rules in relation to business rates, and what it did was it expanded the business rate relief scheme. So we awarded more reliefs during the year than what we budgeted for. So it looks like the collection fund is in a deficit position, but what we've got is we've got compensation from the government through a grant. But because it's a tiny difference, this 77 million will flow through into the following year, and we'll draw down the reserve.
Thank you.